Good afternoon, everyone. Let me get everyone's attention. Welcome to our fourth installment of Trade Talks. And for those of you who have not been at previous ones, we are setting up a set of conversations on where we see the future of the economy and the future of the world. And we're trying to engage leading thinkers, talking about where we think the world is going, to help us come back to questions: what are the implications for the American government, and then in particular, what are the implications for the trade investment pillar at the Department of Commerce? And then for those of you in the ITA, we're going to try to connect this all back to how do we at the ITA play here. We are trying for the first time to have this as a live broadcast, so we have both people in the room, but we're broadcasting globally, and some people I know are going to be following on the web with the slides, so we're also trying to innovate, and I know you're going to talk about the global impact of industrial innovation. We're trying to innovate as we go here. We have two great speakers. And one I think is known to many people here, both from General Electric, from GE, and I hope, Marco, I will pronounce your name appropriately, Marco Annunziata. Close enough. Chief Economist and Executive Director of Global Market Insight at GE and responsible for global economic, financial, and market analysis to support GE's business strategy. Great background in the financial sector, previously at Deutsche Bank, before that at the IMF. And then our second speaker that I know a lot of folks around the room know, Karen Bhatia, who's the Vice President and Senior Counsel for Global Government Affairs and Policies for GE, and a longtime colleague, I would say, Deputy U.S. Trade Representative, U.S. Secretary, Assistant Secretary for Aviation and International Affairs at Transportation, and even at Commerce, a Deputy Undersecretary. I, as the Deputy Undersecretary of the ITA, have particular fondness for Deputy Undersecretaries. And then before that, at Wilmer Cutler and Pickering as an attorney. Our topic today, and I had the opportunity to look through the slides, the future of work, the global impact of industrial innovation. Many people at Commerce know that we, the U.S. government, are the global partner of the Hanover Fair, the country partner of the Hanover Messe, and in that conversation, we have been talking around where do we see advanced manufacturing go, smart manufacturing, and I'm very interested in both hearing you talk about this, what you see the implications to be, and then connecting back again, I think, Karen, as you were talking about it, what are the implications for us, and we have a concrete event nine months from now, which I think will be a great forum for talking further about this. So then, in that spirit, I'm going to turn the floor over to Marco. He and Karen will speak, and then we'll open the floor to questions. So again, thank you in advance for what I know will be a fascinating conversation.
Thank you very much. Thanks for the kind introduction, and thanks for having us here. It's a great pleasure. What I will try to do is go first through the framework of industrial innovation. At GE, in my role as chief economist, I look at it from a double perspective. One is how industrial innovation is impacting the company, the business model, the competitive environment we're in. And the second is more the macro impact. So what kind of impact is it having and will it have on global economic growth, growth in different countries, the competitiveness of different countries, therefore potentially flows of trade. And I find it fascinating because as you listen to the debate on innovation today, it's very polarized. There seem to be almost schizophrenic attitudes because on the one hand you have people arguing that this new wave of innovation, digital innovation, is powerless to affect economic activity in any way. You have distinguished academics who compare this innovation to the Industrial Revolution, and they say the Industrial Revolution was big. That created wealth. It really improved the situation across the world, changed life in a number of countries. Compared to this, they say the innovation you see today is just silly games, social media. It doesn't change life at all, and productivity, in fact, is languishing. At the other extreme, and almost sometimes within the same people, you have the view that this kind of innovation is profoundly disruptive in a negative way, that it will increase unemployment, widen income inequalities even further. And it's fascinating to see these two points of view, just complete disregard for innovation, writing it off, and utter fear, sometimes combined in the two, in the same people. I think it's a measure of the uncertainty that we face. So from a company perspective, what we see right now is that the pace of industrial innovation is accelerating. So things are moving faster, which explains the sense of urgency that we feel. We've called, we've used the label the future of work to sort of describe this new wave of industrial innovation because we think it will profoundly reshape the way that work is done, the way that workers will operate in the factories, the way that operations of big companies like ourselves will be organized, but also the way that economies will be structured. And we see it as organized across three different pillars: the industrial internet, advanced manufacturing, and the global brain. So let me briefly tell you a little bit about each element in turn, starting with the industrial internet, which we at GE have been talking a lot about over the last 2 or 3 years. The industrial internet, in a nutshell, is taking sensors, lots of electronic sensors, and implanting them into industrial machines, ranging from gas turbines to the jet engines on airplanes to medical devices. Once you do that, you start collecting a huge amount of data from the industrial machines. And then the next step is you use sophisticated software to sift through the data and try to figure out how can you gather from this data insights that tell you how to operate the machines more efficiently. Can you fly an airplane in a way that the jet engine becomes more efficient and consumes less fuel? And what this does is lead you to a situation where you can move, I think from a business perspective, we like to talk about reducing unplanned downtime. So basically what you do is you try to move from a situation where you fix things when they break to a situation where you can have a better sense of when they are likely to break and you can intervene before the accident, the malfunction happens. The reason why this is important is if you think of traveling by airplane, it means that instead of finding yourself stuck on the tarmac because you've boarded and before the flight takes off, the pilot figures out there is something wrong and then you're stuck for 2 hours. It means knowing that the airplane needs to be fixed, maintained ahead of time so that the airline can plan around it and then your plane will leave on time. So this delivers huge gains in productivity and in efficiency, which ultimately we think, as an economist, I think will ultimately translate in faster economic growth and more jobs and incomes. The second pillar of this transformation is advanced manufacturing. Now, advanced manufacturing, some people call it smart manufacturing, is a combination of different elements. Part of it is different production processes. And 3D printing is probably the best known example. It's important because once you use 3D printing or additive manufacturing, you can actually start producing parts which are completely different, so have different physical properties. You can make different objects than you can make with any other techniques. So you can make industrial machine components which are lighter or more robust, or a combination of the two. But it's also, again, data-driven. So advanced manufacturing is not just 3D printing. It's also using sensors and data to connect everything that happens on a factory floor and connect a GE factory or any other factory with information on the supply chain and the distribution channel, which means that you remember, for example, when we had the earthquake in Japan some time ago, one of the big impacts that had on the economy was a disruption of supply chains, because all of a sudden you were waiting for parts coming from somewhere in Japan and they would not show up. Now, once you have full leverage over the data through advanced manufacturing, what you can do is you can instantly readjust your supply chain. So you will know immediately how you can adjust by changing the sourcing of your materials to react to this shock. You can also do things like, suppose that you want to design a new part. Suppose that, again, you're building a jet engine and you want to do it in a different way. Advanced manufacturing allows you to get on a computer and try to simulate what the new engine will look like, but also how you will need to reconfigure your production process to make that happen. And you can do that very quickly and very much ahead of time. So this is a process that translates in much greater speed and flexibility than we've ever seen before. It also has some interesting implications because it does two things. It changes the nature of economies of scale. Traditionally, as an economist, I've been brought up with the idea that the way you achieve economies of scale is you make a huge investment in an industrial plant, and then to justify that investment, you have to start producing huge numbers of exactly identical products, more or less. You achieve scale, the investment pays off. With advanced manufacturing and techniques like 3D printing, you can produce different parts, different objects with the same machine simply by changing the software you put into the machine. And you can go very quickly through a cycle of designing a product, building a prototype, testing it, modifying it. So all of a sudden, you can achieve scale in an economic efficient way by producing smaller number of different elements. So this potentially changes the way in which factories are now structured. And by changing the nature of economies of scale, it can also enable the possibility of microfactories. So if you can produce on a much smaller scale in an economically efficient way, all of a sudden, new possibilities for deciding the location of the factories open up. You can decide to place some of them where you can find the right skilled labor, where energy is cheaper, where you can be closer to your customers, to your market. So it introduces a huge degree of flexibility and potentially the ability to reshape the way that the economic footprint of companies is articulated. The third element, we called it global brain, but essentially it's, think of social media and all the various communication systems we have right now. These now enable the collaboration of people across the globe. Now, there are very different ways of leveraging this. One is the classical system of conference calls and video conferences, but the most powerful one and the one we found most disruptive is crowdsourcing, where you try to get expertise and intelligence scattered around the world and not necessarily from your own employees to bear upon a problem that you are trying to solve. And I'll give you an example of this in a little while. What this does is accelerate the process of innovation, in a sense almost trivially, because you're getting more resources and a wider range of resources to bear on the same problem, on the same question. So three elements, industrial internet, advanced manufacturing, and global brain, constituting this innovation process. One question that usually comes up when we discuss it is, why do we talk so much about it now? Because a lot of these things, both 3D printing and electronic sensors, have been around for a while. So why are we so excited today? And the reason is that there has been a sharp decline, an accelerating decline, in the cost of physical electronic sensors and in the cost of storing and processing data thanks to cloud computing. So it's really the process by which gathering, storing, and processing the information suddenly becomes so much cheaper. This is what is enabling these innovations to achieve speed and scale right now. And the process is accelerating quite fast. As a consequence, you're now beginning, so 2-3 years ago when we launched the concept of the industrial internet, it was more a framework. Now you have a number of examples where this is translating into real economic value in different sectors and for individual companies, for individual economies. I've put a few examples here on this slide. The one on the extreme left is one of my favorites, is on wind power generation. Here you have a technology that with software that links together the wind turbines on a wind farm. And what happens is when the wind changes going through the farm, this software allows the wind turbines to pretty much talk to each other, communicate with each other, and react to the changing conditions in a coordinated way. Because what you want to do is you want to maximize the power that you extract from the flow of wind as it flows through the first line, second line, third line of turbines, etc. Which means you don't necessarily want the first line of wind turbines to absorb as much of this power as possible. It's a trade-off between how much energy they produce and how much wind passes through. And so what you do is you allow the turbines to react and change the inclination, the pitch of their blades in a coordinated way. And as you work with this technology, you end up with a 5% increase in annual energy output for a wind farm as a whole. So this is very, very significant. It's something we haven't seen before. Similarly, you can apply similar technologies to rail transportation, to aviation, to healthcare, and you end up reducing fuel consumption, reducing delays, increasing speeds. So we are now seeing it implemented across companies, across sectors, in an accelerating pace. And now it's real. So at the micro level, you can see that the impact is real. It is significant. When we first talked about the concept and we were trying to figure out how big can this be, we did it with the idea of the power of 1%. So what we did was, within the company, we talked with our scientists, our engineers who were starting to develop these solutions. And the consensus was that these new technologies being developed could improve efficiency by at least 1% in all the sectors that we were looking at. So then you say, okay, what is 1% worth? And we went through the sectors that we are operating in, so aviation, energy, rail transportation, et cetera, and we did it in a very bottom-up way, which is you go and count exactly, you know, how many machines are out there, how costly is it to operate. And so you can start to figure out, in monetary terms, if you can gain a 1% efficiency over a period of time, how much do you gain? And you see the estimates on this slide. Over a period of 15 years, it adds up quite significantly, because you end up having savings up to $90 billion in the oil and gas industry, $30 billion in aviation. So the savings are big, and this is, we took 1% as a lower bound, because in the sense within our community of engineers and scientists was at least 1% is definitely achievable. But as you've seen in the previous slide, what we are achieving now as you go on specific solutions is significantly higher than 1%. So these are examples, specific examples of industrial internet applications. This here is a diagram of the what we call the brilliant factory. So it's the factory that is powered by advanced manufacturing techniques. And as I said, the big advantage here is really the redefinition of the economies of scale. And the third element, the global brain, here is the example I wanted to give you. So we've talked a lot about crowdsourcing, but at GE, crowdsourcing is a very, or was a very foreign concept, because we're a large company, we've been around for 130 years. We have a huge global research department full of scientists and engineers. We've always done research and development in-house, we're very proud of it, and we think we have the best people. And I would argue we do. But some of us were pushing, you know, these innovations are going on, why don't we try crowdsourcing? So after a lot of internal discussion, we launched this jet engine bracket challenge. So what we did was we identified one component, which is a jet engine bracket. It's a relatively simple component, as much as anything related to jet engines can be simple. What it does is it attaches the engine to the body of the plane, so it's pretty important. And what we did was we went on one of these crowdsourcing platforms, GrabCAD, which is full of vetted engineers, and we said, here is the design of the part we are using today. We are challenging you, the community of engineers out there, to give us a design for a different kind of component. So make this is what we have now. Can you make it better? And can you give us a design that can be produced with 3D printing techniques? And a design that has to be at least as strong as what we have now, but has to be lighter, because it's an airplane, so the less weight you have, the more fuel you save. We had a number of very high quality submissions, and the winning design came from a young engineer in Indonesia. This is somebody who had no prior experience in jet engines or in aviation whatsoever, none. A guy submitted a design that is not only stronger than what we had before, it is 84% lighter than what we had. So when our aviation engineers saw it, the first reaction, of course, was my reaction as well, was can't be. It can't be, that can't be right, it can't possibly work. And then they looked at it again, and they prototyped it, and they tested it, and sure enough, it works. So this is what we're using now. And for us, it was an eye-opening experience, because as I mentioned earlier, if I look at it as a naive economist, my reaction is, well, it's obvious, right? You open it up to a larger number of experts, you come up with something better. But the expert who did this had no experience in the field whatsoever. So what this teaches you is that not only you have the benefit of opening up to a different set of people, but also that the people who come to the problem with a different background and a fresh set of eyes sometimes will come up with a much better solution than any expert will think of. Then from a company perspective, it raises some very interesting questions, because we've done it for one relatively simple component. And in a competition like this, what you do is you promise to the winner a certain amount of cash, not huge, and fame. So fame and a little bit of fortune. But if you want to do it for a smaller component, it's enough. It's enough of an incentive. But you look at this and you say, this is powerful. What if we could crowdsource a much wider range of our products, of our production techniques? And then the question becomes, how do you do it? How do you do it in a way that protects your intellectual property, in a way that allows you to provide the right incentives to the people out there? Because for a smaller component, people will do it for fame and half of a fortune. But for something that potentially changes the profitability of one of the lines of businesses of a large company, if I were on the outside, I would want to have more of a stake in the upside. So how do you do this? But on the other hand, you look at this and you think, if this is so powerful, it will be done. If we don't do it, somebody else will. Especially as with advanced manufacturing, it becomes much easier to produce individual components of big, complicated machines at lower scale. So this is profoundly disruptive and potentially changes the way that companies in the future will think about their workforce. Rather than having a huge concentrated workforce on permanent staff in one place, wouldn't you want to have a more flexible workforce that you can tap somehow on demand? It raises very complicated issues, both from the company perspective, but also from the perspective of society, social benefits, how do you deal with temporary unemployment. But as you see, the economic power from this is enormous. So from a company perspective, and this is not just GEO, this is something that we discuss with companies across the world, if you want to succeed in adopting these innovations, you need to do several things. You essentially need to change your business model, and the first thing you need to do is to invest significantly in your ability to use software. Now, in our case, we've opened the software center in Saint Ramon, so the investment was substantial. Can be done at smaller scale, but you need to understand the software, you need to integrate the software and the digital technologies into the physical world, and you need to make more use of collaboration and innovation, both within your company, but also with the external environment. And we are used to doing everything by ourselves. We are now a lot more active in building links with startups, smaller companies, universities, because we're entering into a world where people and companies do collaborate more, and we feel that no matter how big you are, no matter how smart you are, you can't do it all by yourself. So this, I think, is going to spur a lot more partnerships, joint ventures, cooperations across companies and across borders, which is also going to have interesting implications from a global economy perspective. Let me just give you a couple more slides. I wanted to show you some of the examples of how these innovations are being adopted in different countries. Because what's happening now is both individual companies and individual countries are looking at this and thinking, this looks pretty powerful. How can we use it to solve our problems, to address our priorities? China is one example. We tend to think of China still as a country that is imitating, copying, stealing technology and therefore growing fast through traditional manufacturing. But they are realizing that for them, the game of growth through lower cost manufacturing is over. Their wages are starting to rise. They need higher wages because they need to change their growth model from excess investment to more domestic consumption. So they need faster productivity growth. So they need to adopt better technologies, plus they need to ensure greater energy sustainability because otherwise their pollution goes under control. And of course, they have the challenge of improving healthcare across huge countries. So they are now jumping onto this train as well, and they're trying to introduce advanced manufacturing techniques to move up the value-added scale in a number of their production facilities. So they're really pushing hard to embrace smart manufacturing and become, if not leaders, one of the stronger countries in this field. They are investing a lot to improve the efficiency of renewables for the strengthening of their energy production system. And they are applying a lot of these techniques in the healthcare sector because it allows them to manage healthcare operations more efficiently, but also it allows you to have healthcare operations that reach deeper into the countryside. We have some of these activities in China where we have remote centers that can control the operation of healthcare equipment in remote hospitals and help the staff over there address any malfunction or technical problems. Similarly, in Australia, and Australia has the problem of being excessively reliant on commodities. The mining sector went through a huge boom and then pretty much a bust as commodity prices adjusted. And now the entire mining sector needs to figure out how they improve productivity and efficiency. And it's a problem for the economics of the entire country. And so they are launching new techniques, including some pioneered by local mining companies, where they use autonomous vehicles, they use remote monitoring operations. So a lot of the techniques that I've talked about in the previous slides are being adopted in a sector like mining, which we don't tend to think of as a particularly advanced and high-tech sector. South Korea, I was there last week, similar story. They need to relaunch growth, which has slowed down significantly. They need to face the challenge of an aging population. Also enormous interest on that side, and they're trying to figure out how can they make more space for smaller companies. They've always relied on these half state-owned large corporations. How can they trigger more activity from smaller and more innovative companies? Similarly, last point in Turkey, you go to Turkey and you find out there is a very vibrant movement of fabrication labs, makers movements. So little operations, little labs where you have people from all walks of life playing around with 3D printing machines and coming up with new products. Plus you have a surprisingly high number of companies coming up with innovative industrial internet-like solutions in the retail industry, in energy management. So a lot of innovation. This is something that I found quite eye-opening working on this. The US is definitely at the forefront of this, but the way in which different countries responding to their own needs and incentives are adopting very quickly pieces of this innovation is actually quite striking. And it's interesting because it tells you that this does indeed have the potential to change the competitive landscape across countries. These are new technologies which move very fast. So some of the emerging markets could leapfrog existing technologies, become more competitive in specific sectors. So the final message I would give you before giving the podium to Karen is, this is hugely disruptive. So we are looking at it, and while it will take a bit of time for the full macro impact to be felt, it is hugely disruptive. So within the company, we are taking it extremely seriously. It will reshape the way that you see competition across companies, across countries. It will have a potential strong impact on how work is organized and on the trade flows. So it's something that I would say is definitely worth taking a very serious look at. So thanks for this, and let me leave it to Karen.
Great. Marco, thanks very much. Ken, thanks for the introduction. It's great to be back at the Commerce Department. As Ken mentioned, I'm a proud alumnus of the department. I worked 12, 13 years ago back in what was then called BXA, now called BIS. That will date me. And before I comment on Marco's thing, I was actually reflecting on it on my time at BXA coming back. A little vignette, completely unrelated to the industrial internet or anything else, but a little vignette about actually the practice of law in a U.S. government agency. One of my first assignments, I remember when joining the Commerce Department, actually brought me down into this very library, and I was charged with, the new undersecretary at that point in time wanted to change the name of the department. So I said, fine, sir, I'll go figure out how do we do that, and came back with a copiously well-written memo on all of the legal things that you needed to do as a U.S., as an agency within the Department of Commerce to change your name. Long list of things we needed to do. Unfortunately, what I omitted to mention was that one might want, although not technically legally necessary, one might want to go mention it to one's congressional appropriators that you were going to change the name of the agency before you in fact do it. Well, those of you who have had the privilege of working with congressional appropriators will understand the good humor and the understanding that they had when they read about the name change in the press rather than being approached beforehand. So happily, after much groveling and kissing of 21-year-olds' rings, we were able to move forward, and we didn't have our budget zeroed out. And as I understand it, BIS continues to flourish today. A completely unrelated story to what Marco's presentation was. And so look, with respect to what Marco just presented, I decided to live off of an aphorism that's gotten me quite far in my life thus far, which is, if you can simply borrow on the good work of other people and deliver small comments at the end, by all means do so. And so all I'm going to do is simply make a few observations about what Marco's just described and present maybe a few ideas about what I think you all, as leaders in the U.S. government, particularly working to strengthen U.S. commerce globally, should be aware of. So I'm going to make just 4 points. I think the first is that these dynamics that Marco's describing, these trends that are happening in business, are real and they are global. So lest you think that what Marco's laid out is some sort of arcane GE-specific view of the world, I would say you need to take another look. If you talk to strategists at many large companies, we do, as Marco referenced, I think you're going to find that they are thinking about this exact same set of issues, the same set of dynamics. They're thinking about how are we, we're at this dawn of a new age of communications among machines. How do we leverage that? About the power of big data to generate efficiencies for their customers. About the innovative powers, the extraordinary innovative powers of being able to leverage global brains, these crowdsourcing modes of innovation. And particularly for companies in the manufacturing space, I think they're thinking a lot about the application of these new technologies, 3D printing, artificial intelligence, and whatnot, into manufacturing. And moreover, they're not just thinking about it, they're putting their money where their minds are. They are investing based on this vision of the world. I can tell you, at GE, as Marco alluded to, it's informing our R&D strategies, it's informing our HR strategies, what kind of people we're hiring. It's informing our investments, informing our product offerings, our entire business strategy. And it is driving hundreds of millions of dollars of investment by GE. So, and we think we are just one of many companies out there that are doing that. I would note also, interestingly, I think it's informing and in some ways reshaping the culture of our company. The kinds of changes we're talking about, this merger of hardware and software, doesn't fit nicely into or smoothly into a company that has a 130-year tradition of being a manufacturing company, of being a company of engineering excellence. And so we're having to work hard to think about how do you permit and encourage the kind of revolution, the kind of disruptive thinking that doesn't just permit these kinds of changes, but actually embraces them. So the last thing I would make and observe to begin with is my first observation is how globally resonant the vision is that Marco just presented. So when I travel around the world and meet not just with business people but with government officials, these are the subjects I get asked about. I get asked about what we're doing with the industrial internet. I get asked about the global brain, this idea of global crowdsourcing, and I get asked a lot about advanced manufacturing. They want to know, government officials want to know, what are we doing and how they can be part of it. And governments are thinking strategically about this set of developments and thinking about how do they get ahead of it. So the fact that you all are thinking about the same set of issues, I think, is very appropriate. Second observation. The second observation I have about the future of work that Marco describes is that it's going to have fundamental consequences for the distinction that we have drawn to date between goods and services. So historically, I think you've had fairly stark delineations between the two. MRI machines are goods, equipment maintenance is a service. Aircraft engines are goods, consulting on how to improve efficiency is a service. Now, the changes that Marco's describing, that our business is moving toward, really sees a complete erosion of that distinction. The merger of goods and services. Now, that merger is going to have implications for a number of policy areas, but I think none more so than trade. The separation between goods and services has always been pretty stark for trade. Trade agreements have goods chapters and services chapters, goods negotiators and services negotiators, some trade negotiations that are entirely devoted to just one or the other. Trade data, for instance, is separated to goods versus services. And the politics of trade politics between goods and services have also been distinct. You have goods companies, manufacturers like GE, and services companies, banks, insurance companies, telecom companies, and so forth. Different constituencies, often different trade orientations. Now, what Marco is describing is a world where you take goods and services, hardware and software, and inextricably link them. Where the value of the flow of data coming off these machines may be worth far more than the machines itself. Indeed, some have imagined, have postulated a world where OEMs, original equipment manufacturers like GE, may discount or even give away the hardware in exchange for the stream of income derived from the data on the services side. Now, one other point to be made is that the distinction in this world between manufacturing companies, companies like a GE or a Boeing, and services companies like an IBM or a Google may also erode. From a trade policy perspective, I think this has a number of implications, but I'll name just two right now. First, I think it means that the separation of goods from services and data as a trade negotiating goal just doesn't make much sense. If you care about goods trade, you also need to care just as much about the movement of data and ideas. And you need to care about the rules governing ownership of data and ideas as well. And the second point is that the enforcement of trade rules in this world becomes quite complicated. How do you deal with rules of origin, for instance, when products are globally crowdsourced? How do you enforce export controls when 3D printers permit the production of pretty much any goods anywhere? So the second observation I have, the world that Marco is positing will bring together goods and services in a way that is going to have to force policymakers to reassess the traditional division that has existed between the two, particularly in the area of trade policy. Observation number three. The world that Marco describes should make policymakers think long and hard about what are key policies to be competitive in this new world. This is a big topic. It's beyond the scope of what I can possibly comment on today, but let me flag at least three things. First, people and talent are key. Countries that provide education and training focused on these key disciplines are going to thrive in this world. And those that are not are going to lag behind. Secondly, countries have got to have the infrastructure that permits them to capture the benefits of this world. At a very minimum, electricity, telecommunications, and transportation. And third, countries need to adopt the right set of enabling policies. And in particular, they need to embrace the global linkages that I think are inherent in the vision that Marco has painted. It bears pausing for a moment just to reflect on how inextricably linked these developments are, the global brain, advanced manufacturing, and the industrial internet, how inextricably linked they are, I think, to globalization. And I would submit that these changes, in particular the industrial internet and the global brain, are going to have the effect of, in fact, driving a new wave of globalization, not unlike the consumer internet or containerization have done. Now, can countries opt out? Can they seek to extract or insulate themselves, their industries, their citizens? Possibly. But those that do so are going to do so at their own peril. Without the efficiencies that are offered by big data analytics and the industrial internet or the innovation inherent in the global brain, those countries' competitiveness, I think, is going to be fundamentally compromised. So observation number three, the future of work that Marco describes will encourage governments, I think, to commit to policies that will make their economies more competitive in the presence of these developments, including a stronger commitment to globalization, ultimately. Fourth observation, lastly, and this is really more of a political or perhaps philosophical point, but the work that Marco is describing is potentially an enormously democratizing development. Think about it. You've got a kid in Indonesia who can design an aircraft engine bracket for GE half a world away. Or you have an entrepreneur with a great idea and access to a 3D printer who can now compete with the world's biggest companies. Or you can have a new company, a startup in a small market, who can benefit from the same scale of data-driven efficiencies as the world's largest companies can. With the changes that Marco is hypothesizing, the traditional barriers to entry, geographic distance, educational pedigree, size, are no longer insurmountable. SMEs, I would submit, are likely to be particular beneficiaries. Think about what the consumer internet has done for SMEs. And now think about the potential benefits to SMEs from the industrial internet, which is forecast by some to be 50 times the size of the industrial internet. In short, these are extraordinary, revolutionary changes. They are ones that will challenge borders and challenge barriers. They will unquestionably create risks and problems. Cybersecurity, privacy, product safety, for example, are all legitimate public policy issues. I don't have the answers to them, but it is important that there be issues that are addressed, lest they give rise to regulation or policies that could deter or delay or strangle in the crib some of the incredibly exciting developments that have been hypothesized. But they may also, to be frank, create political challenges. You are going to have companies that are not at the forefront of this, that are not planning for this new world, that may find themselves looking on the sidelines and then look to slow this development down, set of developments down, in the United States or around the world. And I think those urgings have to be resisted. So let me conclude by just recapping the four observations again that I'd make. The first is that these dynamics are real, and they are capturing the attention of business and government leaders globally. Second, I think they will bring together goods and services in a way that's going to have to cause policymakers to reassess the traditional division that has existed between the two, particularly in the area of trade policy. Third, I think these developments will encourage smart and thoughtful governments to commit to policies that will make their economies more competitive in the presence of these developments. A stronger commitment to globalization, I think, is likely ultimately to be one such outcome. And fourth and finally, these are powerfully democratizing developments, likely to raise some legitimate public policy issues and also potentially to be opposed by those less well prepared for the future, who may see these developments as threatening. Finally, I would like to say that I think that the future Marco describes, is one that is fundamentally good for the United States. I think it is one that we can succeed and thrive in. We have the companies, we have the technology, and I think we have the culture to succeed in this world. But doing so is going to require smart decisions by America's business leaders. It's going to require courage by the American people. And it's going to require far-sighted engagement by key government agencies, including, of course, the Department of Commerce. And we at GE look very much forward to continuing to work with you all to figure our way through this future together. So with that, thanks very much.
So let's open the floor to questions, and let me just begin by asking, I didn't hear you talk about investment flows. I heard you talk about trade flows. And so I'd be curious how you see this impacting investment flows? And again, from the U.S. perspective, how we might talk about this, think about this to draw investment into the country would be a subsidiary question. And then a related question is, and how we should think about helping American companies invest abroad to access some of the, if necessary, global, the outsourcing that we're talking about. Because, you know, sometimes at Commerce, we're in a world where our focus is come to the United States and invest. It's a very good and appropriate task for us. And there are questions about how we should think about helping companies go externally. So, couple part question. How you see investment flows working, how we might use this competitively to draw investment, and then your thoughts about what implications, if any, for us helping companies go external on the investment side in particular.
Yeah, let me give you a few thoughts first. Very good point. I have not mentioned the investment flows, but definitely investment flows will be affected as strongly as trade flows. And what you will see is investment going more and more to the locations, to the countries where the conditions to leverage this innovation will be put in place. Karan had mentioned earlier education and skills. I completely agree. So this is going to be one of the predominant factors that attract investment. Can you go and invest in countries that are not just providing big markets, but countries that are providing the brains, the skills necessary, countries that have the infrastructure to put this production in place. Also because these are trends that will play out over a long period of time. And in the end, what you will see is that countries, let me link this to the issue of commodities, for example, because what we're seeing here is a trend towards greater efficiency. So while commodities will remain important, you will see that over time, countries that have the skills, the education, and the infrastructure that allow the country to grow over time and create a market and create the condition for efficient production are the ones that will attract greater investment. Now, from my point of view, from the perspective of investment into the U.S., this is a hugely positive development. As Karan pointed out, the U.S. as a country is very well positioned to excel in this wave. And we're in a situation where lower labor costs are less and less relevant. Energy costs are more important, but the shale revolution in the US is helping a lot on that front. So this is something that can help attract investment here. But also, it's a world that is more and more globalized. So I think from a policy perspective, helping US companies of all shapes and sizes to find the right strategy and the right channels to globalize, so to invest in the right markets abroad, from my perspective, will be even more important for the success of the companies and the U.S. economy as a whole. And on this note, let me turn it over to Karan.
Marco, I think I agree with everything that you said, and a couple of maybe just discrete thoughts. The first, to be honest with you, Ken, as I think about trade today, the reality is I think about investment for a company like ours. I mean, we no longer, it is a very, very rare product. There is probably no product that GE innovates, manufactures, does everything within a single country, puts it on a boat or a plane and sends it somewhere else. The reality is that we are a web of global value chains and supply chains, and the inherent in that is the investments that we're making. So to begin with, we are already an investment company more than a trade company, I think, in a classical sense. I think the second thing that I would say is the world that, the picture that Marco painted, the future of work that he painted is one that is simply going to double down on that integrated supply chain network, right? Because now you're going to be sourcing brains, you're going to be sourcing products that may be manufactured not in huge factories, but in much smaller factories. And you're going to be connecting all of this through a seamless web of connected machines. So in that world, investment will flow to where
there are the best conditions for the investment to exist, where there's strongest rule of law, where there's regulation that makes sense and is not arbitrary. And in that world, I come back, you know, Marco made the point as well, I think we do quite well. I think we do quite well as a country, and I think you see that happen in times of global duress. You see flows of capital coming into the United States because there is a recognition that we have those strengths. I think what the more challenging question is, what do you do to try and help American companies in this new world go abroad? And I think a couple of thoughts that I would say there. One is it comes back to the point that I was making before, but I think a vigorous, strong, but contemporary U.S. trade policy agenda is key to that. So I think that an agenda that was constructed on an old-style notion of trade where we put things on boats here, sent them abroad, collected our funds, and brought them back to the United States isn't the world that we live in. We live in a world that's far more integrated than that, and where the set of key issues are going to be the ability to move ideas, data, people and capital across borders seamlessly. So I think one thing is we need to be negotiating the right things. I think the second thing that I would say is it comes back to the SME point. I think that is going to be a particularly interesting sort of focal area. How does a small and medium-sized American company engage effectively in this kind of environment? And I think that's an area where I know Commerce is spending a lot of time thinking about, but I would think we value and appreciate enormously the support that we get from the Commerce Department globally. Invaluable. We know how to use the Commerce Department. We have people out there doing it. I think the challenge is for some of these smaller companies, particularly in this new environment, I think that's going to be an area of focus.
It was mentioned earlier that a product may in the future just be completely undervalued in its price because of technological advancement. How do you see that affecting the measurement of growth, specifically GDP?
It's a tricky question, because I personally always prefer not to hide behind the excuse that the statistics are not right and things are being mismeasured. But I feel more and more that when you look at what's happening in the world economy, just take the US, the improvement in the quality of life that we have seen in the last 20 years, that I would say most levels of the income distribution, I don't think is correctly captured and represented in the statistics, in GDP, in the cost of living, because the availability of services which are pretty much free, the improvement in the quality of the products is just enormous. So I think this is a problem that will get worse over time. Statisticians are aware of it, so there is work being done to try to figure out how do we do a better job at capturing this. But I would say while the statistics will remain behind the curve, we shouldn't be too worried, except to the point of, to the extent of not letting ourselves become too pessimistic because the official statistics don't show that big of an improvement, right? Because the point you make is absolutely correct. I don't think there is a quick fix to it, so a quick way to improve the statistics. Then the next question is, why is it relevant? And to me, it's relevant because there is a risk that we fall more into the trap of saying life is not improving, the economy is not growing enough, innovation is being powerless, and then we run into the risk of giving into a backlash against technology. Now, if we buy into the argument that the measurable benefits of technology are not big and the risks are large, you can have a backlash in terms of regulations, in terms of policies. So I think that the answer for me is focusing on the fact that technology is improving growth and life conditions beyond what is captured in the statistics, and that it will be reflected in the statistics going forward. For the rest, it's a direction that matters. So I don't think this will skew, for example, too much inter-country comparisons or the trend that you see in growth.
My question is more a qualitative one. In regards to technology, your policy issues, well, United States has recently allowed technology to be stored in clouds, and other countries have implemented different technology type restrictions, I think. Where do you see, are we going the right way and are other countries going the right way, or is it a mixture of right and wrong and they're going to cancel out each other? Thank you.
I think this is a very dynamic area right now. So I think you're seeing in real time this play out where you have a series, you know, you have different countries experimenting with different sets of solutions or sets of policies around where data can reside, how data can move, where data can be stored and still be compliant with their local laws. If I could wave a magic wand, I would adopt a very liberal, unregulated kind of structure here. Now, I understand that that's not the approach that all governments are taking. There are some out there that have adopted more strict sets of regulations. My own view is that this gets to the point that we were talking about before, which is what do you do to incentivize your country for being an attractive destination? So a country that has robust protections around theft of data, but nonetheless has a fairly liberal regime for permitting data to come in, data to be analyzed, and data to flow out, makes it an attractive place for us to want to invest and build up capabilities here. There are markets abroad, you I'm sure are thinking of some of the same ones that I am, that impose much more strict restrictions around it. Now, does that mean we would not invest in those countries in that space? No. But it would be much less likely that those countries would become a hub for regional activity, let alone global activity, if they're going to impose those kinds of restrictions. If you're a big enough, it's not unlike some of the forced localization requirements that we've seen around manufacturing. If you're a big enough market, you may be able to create sort of an indigenous, walls around the country kind of market unto itself. But you're not going to be attracting investment, and you're not going to be creating you're not going to be capturing the scale of benefits to your own indigenous industry that you would if they had access to big data globally aggregated. So, my sense of it is that the United States has generally been sort of heading in the right direction in terms of its policy here, but it's still yet to play out. I think you're going to see new pressures come in, whether they're privacy, whether they're security, whether they're other things, and I'm wary of being too regulatory in this space, lest you end up sort of stifling the incredible amounts of productivity and innovation that's happening out there in this space.
In trade negotiations and we're sort of an artificial dichotomy of goods versus services, and we should be looking towards the future in some different model. Now that you're no longer in USTR, can you give us a sort of a framework or thoughts on how you could do that without creating the dichotomy, or how do you bring these things together?
I'm sorry, the question, how would you?
Yeah, because you talked about this dichotomy that exists between, negotiate.
Okay, yeah.
And so what should be the model for the future as we go into trade negotiations?
I think it starts with making sure that negotiators, people in government, policymakers, really understand how these things are going to market, so that we are, there's not a dichotomy in how we sell them globally. And understanding that market dynamics, I think, is the first step that I would suggest. I think the next thing that we need to look at is whether the traditional delineation of whether you have chapters that split things up that don't sort of come together is in fact the right way to negotiate it. And I say that not because I necessarily think there are huge gaps out there, but because there are trade-offs that are made in these things. So when you're trading goods for goods, and yet you don't have the services component built into those trade negotiations, you in fact may be not getting what you think you're getting, right? So for us, let's just hypothetically, imagine we make product X, aircraft engines, and we succeed in a particular market in getting very low tariffs on aircraft engines going in. but that there are huge restrictions on our ability to capture data coming off of those or capture the flow of services revenues coming off. That market access just isn't worth that much, right? So I guess what I'm saying is I think you're going to need a trade negotiating construct that puts those two together in some sense. I haven't figured out the boxes, but I think that's the point that I'm trying to make.
Hi. I noted earlier in Mr. Marcos' speech about the trade and supply chains being more efficient and running smoothly with the technology and ability to change where the sources of your supply chain are coming from within your business. But my question to you is, how do you think that could affect the supply chain in general, including different businesses, consumers, suppliers, and such? And with that impact on efficiency, what do you think is going to happen to the market with that new technology?
It's a big question. So I think something that will happen is the supply chain in general will get more complicated, more distributed. So to the extent that, as Karan was mentioning earlier, these innovations have a powerful effect of democratization. We talk about the democratization of manufacturing. You will have the possibility of creating microfactories or smaller suppliers that become part of a more distributed supply chains with more components. So I think you will end up with a supply chain globally that looks like a much more dense network with a much larger number of components, all interconnected. Now, if this is done well, it should increase the resilience of the supply chain overall. That is, it should allow, by multiplying the number of suppliers of different components, it should reduce the vulnerability of the system to one big supplier somehow going offline. However, it will make the system even more interdependent in a global way, and therefore even more exposed to any disruptions to the interconnection itself. And the interconnection goes through the data channel that Karan was mentioning, it goes through trade channels. So it will become more efficient, more distributed, denser, involving a larger number of smaller units, but it will be more global and more interconnected. Now, I think this is good, it creates more efficiency, it will create more value, but as we've seen also in the case of the global financial crisis, when you have something which is globally very distributed and very interconnected, it also becomes harder to understand intuitively. That is, if you're looking at these factories of the future that we are envisioning, you will have the software that allows you to reoptimize your supply chain instantly. But if you are sitting in an office and you're trying to imagine what happens if a shock hits somewhere, in your own brain, you will not be able to figure it out. Just as in the financial crisis, nobody was able to figure out as the shocks were coming where the impacts were going to play up. So it's going to be a lot more efficient, but with a different level of vulnerability than we have now.
Let me add one. If you were to sort of advise us, as you listen to the presentation, you see lots of disruption and opportunity and uncertainty over X number of years. If you were to look 6 to 18 months out, and say, what are the three things that we at Commerce should focus on to help in this area? What would they be? Because we can't accomplish everything, but if there, and there's a lot of uncertainty as this goes forward, so if we were to make some choices, focus on three things or five things in the next 6 to 18, what would they be? And maybe that's an unfair question.
I think one, this isn't going to be a very good answer to you, Kim, but I think one thing that, for me, when I left government and came in and started seeing this develop, and this really has been accelerating in the last 3 or 4 years, but just sort of getting the mindset around what's happening in industry and how this is going to be a revolutionary change, I think, is one basic thing that could happen within the U.S. government writ large. So I think one role for the Commerce Department, as perhaps the department that is most closely following and is most closely integrated with business, is simply getting better acquainted with what's happening out there, understanding this, having, I mean, this could be the beginning of a much longer dialogue, obviously, into this, and it's not just GE. There are, you know, a lot of other companies that you could engage in. And then helping drive an educational process through the administration around this, I think, would be helpful. Because the end of the day, this isn't going to just be the I mean, I could come up with an answer like, okay, you could reallocate more resources or create some dedicated function around advanced manufacturing or around the industrial internet, and maybe there would be some utility in that. But at the end of the day, I think what this really requires, and it comes back to that point I was making about what does it take to be globally competitive, to be really as a country at the forefront of this. And I think it comes mostly from I think a lot of it will come from having the right set of policies in place in areas that are outside of the Commerce Department's remit. So I think we need, again, education, I think we need energy policies, I think we need, there are a lot of other areas out there. So perhaps the most useful thing I think the Commerce Department could really do is help sort of explain this sort of transformation that's happening within the government, and then perhaps pulling those people together to say, okay, now what are we doing? What is our, you know, industrial internet or advanced manufacturing strategy? What's the energy component to that? What's the healthcare component to that? And sort of playing that convening role. So that's one idea.
I would add to this also focusing on the importance of openness and the point you raised earlier, Ken, which was helping U.S. companies, especially small and medium companies, to globalize, to go abroad. Because one thing that concerns me is this trend we've seen creates an enormous amount of uncertainty for everybody. Now, uncertainty usually generates a protective response. And what you see in various countries around the world is exactly the same defensive response that says, how can I protect myself? How can I protect my own industry? How can I protect jobs in my own country? Now, if these protectionist pressures prevail, it's a disaster. They will negate a lot of the value that can be created here. And part of the way of preventing this from happening is to show that there is a trend for companies, including U.S. companies, going abroad and creating activity, creating jobs, creating wealth. So really pushing the idea that if done correctly, this becomes a win-win situation for the global economy. But it requires an attitude of openness, which in rising uncertainty is difficult to embrace. It's hard to embrace. And having policy support, both in terms of the messaging and actual support measures like commerce can bring, I think would be extremely helpful.
Hi, I know folks need to get back to work, but you call this the future of work. Could you comment on the future of workers? You said the conditions are good right now in the United States for a variety of reasons. I look around and some of the people here are interns, so they're college students or graduate students, and a few of us who assume in 10 years this very fast-moving innovation is going to overtake us in our jobs. Now, we happen to be in government jobs in a service sector, definitely a service sector, but how do we prepare, and how should the U.S. prepare the kind of skills? This is not just abstract thought. These are people who are going to have their hands on the 3D printers or on the terminals or on the final product. So any advice for the workers of the future?
Yeah, I'll give you a few thoughts first. So from the point of view of the education system first, I think the education system needs more emphasis on science, technology, engineering, math. We should really start thinking about science literacy as we've thought about basic literacy in the past, because the world is becoming a world of higher technological content. It doesn't mean that everybody needs to become a data scientist or an engineer, not at all, but there needs to be more familiarity with these concepts. The second thing which is needed is, I think, a closer connection between the education system and industry, right? In some cases, with community colleges, this is working well. At GE, we're running things like innovation labs where we get students in to put their hands on a 3D printer, see what's going on, see what can be done. I would also say it's important to realize that we need a system where students, but also younger workers, become comfortable with greater flexibility and adaptability, because we're mapping out some of these changes, but we can't figure out exactly how they will play out. So we have some ideas for some of the jobs that will be needed, and they will require a combination of traditional technical, mechanical skills together with familiarity with data and with software, but we can't figure out all the new jobs that will come out. So that will require a certain amount of flexibility on the part of the workforce to get ready for that. And the final consideration I would make is that this discussion often tends to create a lot of concern, so the fear that this innovation will destroy jobs. One thing we see within industry is some of these innovations are actually making jobs easier for workers of different skill levels, right? Because in the same way in which I can carry around an iPad and it makes my job easier, you have similar technologies that for technicians within industrial companies make it much easier to access information, to figure out how to monitor or find the problem with the machine. So some of these innovations are actually quite enabling and empowering for workers at different levels. So I think the bottom line for me is really bring the education system closer to industry, up the value-added scale in terms of basic scientific literacy, and get it ready for more flexibility and more adaptability.
I echo everything Marco said. I think he's covered the answer pretty well. The only thing I would add is, I think for a number of these different, particularly for the global brain and to some extent for the advanced manufacturing, I think the traditional notions that we have of what it means to work, right? I think the idea of, okay, I have a job, I go to this place, I, you know, show up at 9 in the morning, I leave at 5 in the afternoon, or the Commerce Department later than that, but, you know, I think that notion of work is a very, you know, 20th century notion of work. I think what you're looking at will be a much more unconventional, you know, bespoke, you know, somebody is doing innovative work in Indonesia for GE one day and maybe for another company somewhere else and something. And so this idea of sort of a very traditional work structure is something that's probably not consistent with the future that we're talking about. Obviously, there will always be some set of employees for big entities, but I think much more is going to be much more nimble than that, and it's much going to be much more fluid than that. And I think that then from a policy perspective, what it requires is the safety nets and the enabling structures to be able to allow people to work in those sort of what we today consider to be still somewhat unstructured, unconventional environments. And I think if you even look, I mean, I have kids who are, you know, they say, oh my God, how on earth could you possibly work at the same place for X number of years? I'm going to get bored. That would never be what I would do. I think there is a tolerance. I think there is an acceptance and, in fact, an enthusiasm for some of that until things get really hard and get really bad, and then they're okay. So I think we need to come up with, as a policy matter, things that will enable them to work in that setting, because I do think ultimately that's going to be most efficient and probably most consistent with the future that Marco's painted.
Let's take maybe one more question. I have a final question.
Okay.
Okay. Hello, good afternoon. I found it very interesting, your observation about it being a combination of hardware and software, especially because these products traditionally have very different life cycles. With hardware, we look at its durability, quality control, and maintenance over the course of years, sometimes decades. With software, we innovate faster than we repair. They're very disposable products in some cases. So I was wondering if you had seen that kind of tension and how you think companies can respond, and if that might change how we view software with industrial applications. Thank you.
It's an issue, it's a question actually that I pose to our people, which is, and it, interestingly, it poses real policy challenges in one sense. I'll describe it to you in sort of the critical infrastructure protection sense. So you're exactly right. You create hardware that's out there and you're going to assume has a lengthy life, and then the software sits on top of that, and it's not like unlike any other set of software. You know, you have patches, you have improvements, you have things that will flow in. From a policy standpoint, this is not exactly your question, but what's interesting to me is there are a lot of places around the world that when you start dealing with the kind of hardware that, say, a GE manufactures, so power generation equipment, as an example, or water treatment equipment. You have government saying, oh, what do you mean you're pushing in software into my water treatment equipment plant? That's, you know, hugely risky. We're going to need to control that. We're going to need to understand that and so forth. So I think to your point, absolutely, software is going to work on that faster. You're not creating software going into these machines that are going to last the length of a gas turbine. But there are going to be updates and so forth that will flow into that. But that does create that sort of remote connection into the hardware, creates policy challenges that, you know, policymakers here and abroad are wrestling with.
So let me ask one last question and then ask you maybe after you answer it, any final words, all right? But the question I want to ask is, and we've been talking about a little bit, is leave the how does the market look to what are the implications for the organization, right? And you just started talking about different ways of thinking about work. I'd be curious how you at GE, and if you have any thoughts, are trying to do the integration that you've talked about. Because we have, for instance, a manufacturing group in the ITA and a services group, right? And I'd be very curious for any thoughts on how organizationally we should think about dealing with these changes so that we're not so siloed that we don't see what we should. And then after any thoughts on that topic, any final thoughts you might have? Sort of a closing comment or two.
Let me start in a few thoughts on your question. It's not easy. So integrating this is not easy at all. The way we've been trying to do it at GE so far is, first of all, build the expertise we didn't have. So creating the software center, bringing in people who have the data, the software expertise, who were not there before, and give them a critical mass, a critical weight within the organization. Then we try to have very, very strong connections between the physical side of the business and the software side of the business. So there are software experts who are embedded in the industrial teams. Work is being done constantly. And we're trying to generate discussions within the company that do exactly what Karan was mentioning earlier. That is, let's take seriously and understand the fact that now services and goods are becoming inextricably joined. So let's move away from a culture where even we as a company always thought of producing the best hardware and then selling it, and then second stage maybe have some nice software on top, to thinking, no, we are not selling goods anymore, we are selling solutions, value to our customers, call it however you want, but it's a mixture of software and hardware, and how do you do this? And you can do it only by creating more moments of cooperation, of joint conversation. So communication first, and then the harder part, which is for us, how do you translate this into a business, a commercial strategy? So how do you change the way you approach your customers by pushing the idea that you're selling something completely different? And from your perspective, instead, it goes to the point that Karan made earlier, but
I think it's, there's no one, it, as Marco says, this is hard, and this is hard for us, and I think it's hard for any entity. I think there are a couple of things that I point to. One is, if this is a vision that a company buys into and agrees at the most senior levels, it falls to the leadership to drive that message down. And so we see that happening a lot in our company. So from our chairman on down, this is a key central theme. It gets driven down. So part of it's leadership and messaging. Part of it is organization and structure, right? So having people dedicated to this, whether it's pulled together or embedded in the different businesses. And so we're doing that as well. So there's sort of a people, there's an organization. There are processes, you know, so there's a pretty regular rhythm that each of our businesses is working with, reporting up on what they're doing to innovate in this area and so forth. I think we are actually benefited in some sense by the pressures of the market, because we have customers demanding this. You know, we have, and as a result, we have business people who might be skeptical to begin with, ultimately saying, God, we actually have to do this. We're not going to be successful as a company 5 years from now if we haven't innovated in this area. So notwithstanding the fact that it's sort of tough for us culturally, I think we are getting there, but it's when you have a company of 130 years going back to Thomas Edison, thinking of themselves as technologists and innovators in around physical things, all of a sudden saying, "Oh my God, we've got to become a software company. We've got to become a data company," is hard. It's hard, and it's a challenge for our HR people, and it's a challenge for our leadership. But I think we seem to be making decent progress.
So let me then give you an opportunity for any last thoughts. I think it's been an incredibly interesting and stimulating, you know, much for us to think about. But any last thoughts?
As a parting thought, I would urge you to really take this seriously, because it's big and disruptive, and it's being completely underestimated because the impact is spreading gradually. But what's happening here is basically talking about information, right? Data is information. Now you're embedding information into the industrial system, and there is a huge base of industrial machines across the world. So as these machines get transformed through sensors, data, and the use of information, the changes this brings are going to be revolutionary. So I think from our perspective as a company, from yours as a commerce department, take it seriously and be prepared for this trend to trigger sudden big changes in pieces of industry, in countries, in companies that you have to support. Be prepared for something which is big and very difficult to fully map out ahead of time.
I don't have any profound last thoughts other, Ken, than to say a couple of things. First of all, I said it before, but I'll say it again. You guys are terrific. We are enormously grateful for what the Commerce Department does in multiple different ways. A lot of different bureaus and agencies here are great partners to us. So just first of all, a big thank you on that. I guess, secondly, this is hard to sort of, I mean, from a single presentation to sort of get everything that's going on, but I would just offer us as a company that the more you or anybody in this room or anybody else wants to explore this with, we'd be delighted to do so. We have great technologists who we can engage in dialogue with. We'd be happy to host you at one of our facilities to show you sort of how these products are playing out and being innovated. We succeeded recently in capturing one of your alumni, Albert Ting, over in our shop. We lost Sarah Bonner, who I see over there in the back, so it's tit for tat there. But Albert's a great resource for everybody here who has any questions. Should feel free to connect with him directly as well.
Well, again, thank you very much.
Thanks.
Thanks very much.
Thanks.